I didn't want to be the first one taking a nosedive into this water as I come down them steps, so had to be careful. Good morning, everyone. So glad that you're here today, and special welcome to several of Blake's family that's here with us today. I look forward to getting a chance. Met some of you. Look forward to meeting others of you, and thank you for coming today, and we're glad that you're here. We had a big Sunday last Sunday with Easter Sunday, and enjoyed that so much. Don't look for anything less today as we gather together. Remember, now, we wear our mask and things, but if you're safely spaced in your pews during our service, you're welcome to drop your mask if you'd like. When we're singing or something, when you're safely spaced there, if you'd like to do that, you're welcome to do that. If you get up and move about or something, then please, you can put the mask back on if you're going to the bathrooms or whatever, things like that. I want to welcome our folks that's watching live Facebook with our services today as well, and there have been many, and we are thankful for that. You'll notice in the bulletin there's a announcement. Tuesday night, ladies, is Bible study 6:30 in the fellowship hall. We're going to talk about the review that we did, a survey, and talk about what we're going to do with women's ministry coming up. So I want to encourage you to be a part of that, to be with us Tuesday night. And in fact, a little addition is I'm going to bring some carpet samples to our meeting Tuesday night, and get you all to pick out, because the guy's going to bring it Tuesday morning to the office, Natalie, for carpet samples. And look, and we'll be getting ready to put the carpet back down in the basement soon. And he has some similar styles of what we had before. They couldn't match it. They had to take all the carpet up through the hallway, etc. Monday morning we came in, and more water up in the foyer here in the men's bathroom. Last Sunday, for some reason, one of the urinals in the bathroom there stuck, the handle stuck, and come in, there's water in the hallway here and in the bathroom there, and running down into the basement again, where we just tore everything out. And I said, the devil is working on us about this water thing. And but the guys were here from ServPro doing the stuff, so they got it, put fans and got it cleaned up. But we're having to replace all the tile in the men's bathroom and take care of that. So we're going to do that on our own. Some of the guys will be working on that to take care of it. But anyway, just updating you, but I want to thank you for your gifts, for your contributions that helps us to take care of things that happens like that. Thank you so much. We're been blessed to see how that you all have opened your hearts and your pocketbooks over the days, and to do that. And God continues to bless us at Orchard Crest, and like having folks visiting now, looking, coming, and we're kind of getting out a little bit more, but still stay safe, you know, guys, as we're doing that. We still wear a mask, we sanitize, distance safely, speak to someone. Of course, you want to do as you feel led, but again, if you feel like when we're singing or something, take your mask off. Got a new song leader today. Philip's gone on vacation with his family down in Texas. My sweet, precious wife is going to be leading the music this morning. Miss Sharon will be playing the piano. We'll have our praise team up here in a moment after the baptism service to do that. And I have talked long enough, hoping that we got everybody here that's going to be here at the service. All the Sunday school classes hopefully dismissed and things. I want to lift up a special prayer concern for Bill Miracle. Bill, found some spot or something, he said some lymph nodes or something on his pancreas, said it was cancerous. He's going back to the doctor for more tests on Tuesday, but they did tell him that it was the treatable kind, which, thank God, you know, that's what. So pray for Bill. He's one of our security guys. You saw him out front this morning smiling behind his mask and with his ball cap on, and we thank you, Bill. He's listening. We got a camera out there and inside, so we're thankful for him, and we'll pray for others. So God knows the needs as we lift up to him. So if you'll join me in a little word of prayer, and then I'm going to have Blake to come, and we'll have our baptism, and then Deborah after that, Honey, if you'll come and lead us in song. Let's pray. Thank you, dear Father, for the blessing of being here today and for the occasion to follow you in the commandment that you've given us to go into all the world teaching and baptizing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father, and the Holy Spirit. And we ask you to bless this service today in a special way. Speak to our hearts. Thank you for all of our guests and for each of our members and those that are watching the services. Lord, draw us all near to the cross through the Holy Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Blake, my brother, if you'll come. Blake shared his testimony a few Sundays ago in sharing about giving his life to Christ and presenting himself before the church for membership and baptism. And I thank God for him. His mom is here, brothers and sister, sister and brother-in-law, grandfather, grandmother.
Grandma and grandpa, and then my aunt and uncle and her kids.
Aunt and uncle, and praise the Lord. We're so glad that you are here to witness this. And two things that Jesus, in describing about two ordinances, baptism and Lord's Supper. We observed Lord's Supper last week. That we follow as believers, that we observe because it identifies with him. Baptism symbolizes three things. Baptism does not save you. This water has nothing to do other than the act of obedience for it. It symbolizes death, burial, resurrection. Death of Christ on the cross, burial in the tomb, resurrection of coming up out of the liquid grave, the water. It's a public testimony of what Blake has done within his heart as a believer in identifying with all the rest of us believers publicly saying, I'm not ashamed of Christ. When you're a Christian, you ought not to be ashamed of Christ. You know, to let other people know, but also in your life, you know, the way you live your life. We're not perfect. We have a perfect Savior. He's working on us. We come to church so we can just do just a little better if we can as the Lord strengthens us. Blake, in observance to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Rise and walk in the newness of life. God bless you. Amen. Thank you, brother. Be right out.
All right. Wow. What a testimony. And our song that we're starting out with is perfect. Just as Jake has professed his faith in Jesus Christ and gone into believer's baptism, he's demonstrated that he is standing on the promises of God. And that's what we're going to start out with. So if you would, we thank God that everybody's here this morning. Just stand with us as we sing 335.
Stand.
stand, and that's okay, but you can sing where you're seated. I love to tell the story. What is the story? What is the story we're singing about?
Jesus.
What's that?
Jesus.
Jesus? Yes. It's the message of salvation. The message of Jesus and his salvation. Odell's message, and the message today is about walking on water, and it tells us about how Jesus came walking to the disciples as they were out fishing, and he reached out his hand and told Peter, "Come to me." Of course, Peter looked at Jesus and said, "Master, if it is thee, call me to come to you." So think about the faith that Peter had to have. And as Jesus, I mean, can you just imagine? I've got goosebumps just thinking about it. Just imagine. As Peter, you know, and Jesus is saying, come, come. And Peter's eyes were fixed on Jesus. And he stepped out on the water, and he started toward Jesus. But when he took his eyes off Jesus, he sank. So that's important for us in our Christian walk. We need to fix our eyes on Jesus, and we need to follow him and not take our eyes off him, because that's when we lose sight of the goal that we're working toward.
Thank you, Miss Deborah, Miss Sharon. And I'm like Peter. I have a confession to make. I sunk. Perfect illustration for today's sermon. If you lean over too far, Blake, it don't do any good to have waders. Woo, I felt it going all the way down. So I felt like old Peter when he had his eyes on. As long as I was looking up there, I was doing fine. Lord, help us. If you have your Bibles with you, I'd like for you, if you would please, to open them to the Gospel of Matthew. We'll be reading in chapter 14, verse 22 through verse 33. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 through 33. Title of the message is Walking on Water, as Deborah shared with you. And the songs, thank you, honey, beautiful old songs. Did y'all know that Come Unto Me song? Did y'all, that's an old song. Now, we got to kind of pick up on, you know, I like that old-fashioned kind of singing that puts those bottom lines in there, you know, when you get that repeat of doing that. So when we throw some of them in there, you're going to have to, that's like just a little talk with Jesus or something. You're going to have to blurt that out. I need some help, guys, and altos, you know, when coming in there. Those are your parts. And oh, won't it sound beautiful when we do this? So you feel free now. Praise team getting up here. Thank you. We just need some more to come. By the way, it reminds me, Brother Mike was sharing with me, Mike Johnson. He's filling in at over at Pleasant Hope at a church over there. So we'll lift him up today in prayer as they're, he and Janice are over there. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 through 33. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray, and when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the water." I like that, don't you? He said, on the water, emphasize. And he said, Jesus said in verse 29, "Come." And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. So when some people say that Jesus was the only one that walked on water, that's not truly biblically correct, because old Peter did for a short, even though it was a short time. So he, it says here, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Verse 30. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink, and he cried, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, "O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, "Of a truth, thou art the Son of God." May the Lord add the blessing to the reading of his word and grant understanding to our hearts today. As we look in the scripture, we often wonder why such a story is put into the Bible of Jesus walking on the water here. The story really has provided quite a bit of humor for people over the years concerning walking on water, kind of like Jesus turning water into wine. You know, I've heard a lot of jokes about that. I don't know if you have and stuff, where people talking about Jesus turning water into wine, and just like this. I don't know if you heard of or remember, but some of you football fans would know the legend Bear Bryant, Alabama Crimson Tide, football team, college, legend for over the years. And there's a story told about old Bear Bryant. Said his wife got a phone call one day and asking if they could speak to Bear Bryant. And she was on the phone and she's looking out the window. And as she looked out the window she said in their lakeside cottage, and she said, oh, and then they were saying, "Would it be any trouble, you know, to do that, a reporter or someone wanting to talk?" She looked out the window. She said, "Oh, no, he is simply having his morning stroll across the lake." And it sounded like old Bear was walking on water. In fact, there's many that believe that he could, you know, doing it. But he was over, and she said, "He's having his morning stroll across the lake to do it."
And so many had made fun of that, put it in the papers and said Bear could walk on water. Well, it might be helpful in understanding in the Bible, did you know the New Testament is a book that is written by preachers to preachers? Now keep in mind that many of in the Bible, the Old Testament, New Testament alike, that many that have their names like Hosea or Isaiah in the Old Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the New Testament, and so on, is authored by God. God is the author of the Bible. He inspires men and women to write. And I say women because there is the book of Ruth, you know. And so when coming to that place of understanding is that the sermons in the Bible, these were preached, these stories, these are the things that these men and women experienced in their life. They are sharing these stories. It's personal stories that they share. When we look at it and understand here to see what was happening. So a generation passed before the New Testament was ever written. And oftentimes we look at it and think, because it is covering the life of Jesus. So when we say here that the New Testament is written by preachers to preachers, really, because the gospel was to be preached, was to be taught. This was the emphasis of what we had. So everywhere that we see in these stories, and basically when people get upset about some preach, say, oh, I heard that sermon before. You wouldn't believe how many times I've preached different sermons because there's only that one story. Christ and Paul said him that crucified. That is the gospel is to preach about Jesus who was crucified and resurrected in the life. In Romans 1:16, Apostle Paul says, I'm not ashamed of Christ. So it comes, if you're going to talk about Jesus, then you want to talk about him in a positive way because you're not ashamed of him. When you're a little child or when you're an adult, is that we don't ever forget that experience and the stories pass on. So for generations, these stories, they went out. The apostles went out and they preached and people gathered. And this is what came to us from these stories that they experienced for themselves in their life. So it's a beautiful illustration here. Through the power of faith, not so much that the fact of the power of Jesus that can walk upon the water, but is the power that he can free us from our fear and lift us out of the angry waves that seems to kind of pull us down. So I want you to look at four things this morning, if you would with me. First of all, I just make a statement, say this is a simple story. It's simple enough for children, and you know, really the Bible is not, if you think about it, now there's revelation, there are some complications. I don't know why people make salvation so complicated, you know, to come to Christ. Jesus said, like the little children come to him and they say, no, no, don't bother the master. And he said, such is the kingdom of God. Except you come as a little child, you can't come to him. And you have to have childlike faith to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. So the gospel is a simple story, a simple message. When you talk about being saved, we add so much to salvation that we think we got to quit doing this and quit doing that. Do you know you don't have to quit doing anything in order to come to Christ, but there are some things that you have to start doing? Can't be saved unless you recognize that you're lost. To be lost means that you have sin in your life, and that sin you have to confess before the Lord. It's not a secret to the Lord, and why do I have to confess it if he already knows it? Because that's part of our hope to come to Christ and admit as we see ourselves. Peter said, depart from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man. That when we come to this place of being saved, salvation is easy. We are to be able to tell everybody how to get saved. But we make it so complicated, we'll go to the preacher. We'll go to somebody else who say, well, I don't know how to tell anybody. I can't win anybody to Christ. You can't save anybody, but you could witness to somebody. Amen. We could be witnesses to somebody. When we are actually witnesses, we are either a good witness or a bad witness. We're either telling the story or we aren't. You know, you can't tell something that you haven't ever experienced. Amen. But when you experience something, we experience in a story, I saw this. Man, I want to tell you about the wreck I was just right behind the other day. Or I saw this happen at the grocery store. I saw that. We tell stories all the time. All the different, in our family, all we tell stories. We need to learn the old gospel story of telling our experience about our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ who can walk on water. It was an amazing story. But the story itself, Jesus had just finished feeding 5,000. Fishes and loaves. Did a miracle right there. Fed 5,000 with that. Had 12 baskets full left over. And then as he has done this, and the crowd is staying around because part of the crowd was wanting, that's what they wanted. They wanted to keep Jesus giving to them. Sound like a government program. As long as you'll feed me, I'm going to stay. As long as you're going to give me what I want. You know, these are the things. So Jesus had just, and his apostles had witnessed, Jesus had told them to feast. He said, we don't have anything. There was a little boy with some fishes and loaves. And as they were there, you know, had a couple of loaves and five fishes, whatever. And they're there. And the little boy shares that he brought his lunch to sit because he knew the preacher might be a little long. I'm not trying to indicate a thing today. But I do got to dry these britches out, you know, before I leave. But he did. And they saw the miracle. They gathered up the fragments. Everybody was wanting to stay around. They were fed. They had all they wanted to eat. But Jesus tells them, says, you get in the boat. Because you know, it's easy to get too comfortable. It's easy to kind of sit around and say, I just want to be here, Lord, in your presence. We like to stay on the mountaintop. You know, as long, you know, I'm going to live a Christian life as long as it provides all the things I want. I never get sick. I never have any problems. None of these things ever occur to me. You know, some people do sell that to say being a Christian is just a bed of roses, and it's not. There's a lot of thorns. And the false impression that it's given to so many because we experience it in church, we experience it in the gatherings of crowds and different things that sometimes isn't always pleasant. We don't expect to see it, whether it's through the preacher or the deacons or the Sunday school teachers, whether it's politics, whether it's whatever it causes. There are little problems that arise and occurs because we are not perfect. And we have to grow together. We have to grow through our imperfections. And the only way we can do this is come to the one that is perfect. And we got to obey him. We got to listen. They didn't ask questions. They kind of said, well, you know, aren't you coming with us? Jesus said, get in the boat and go to the other side. That was the expression after feeding of these 5,000. And he said, I'm going to go up on the mountain and pray. He dispersed the multitudes, went up, and he was alone, and he was praying. And it says, while he was praying, there was a tremendous wind and waves that beat against the boat, drove it out into the sea. And they were out of control in those waves. There was no way they could control it going to the other side. But the wind and the waves was pushing them in the direction they needed to be going. But it was so boisterous. Water was coming up over the sides of the ship and everything else. And they became afraid. And it was in order to get to the disciples, Jesus, he didn't have a boat. He sent them in the boat. He prayed. You would think while he was praying, he'd say, now, Father, I ask you if the boys are having trouble out on the sea. And would you just calm it? If you think that Jesus doesn't end. Jesus said, you're in the world. You're not of the world. They persecuted me. They're going to persecute you. Don't they ever think that you're not going to have problems as a Christian and a Christian family? Our problem, the real problem is how we deal with the problems. Jesus could just as have easily controlled the sea from where he was praying. It wasn't that he wasn't aware of what's going on. He was in perfect view of being able to see the sea from a high point to where he was. He knew there was not one moment that he did not know what was going on in their life. There's not one moment that God doesn't know what's going on, what's happened to you in your past or in your future or whatever it is that you're dealing with or struggling with within your life, but yet God has allowed those things to happen to you for a reason. Those things happen to me for a reason. But it's in the midst of all those troubles that Jesus, in order to get to them, we see him walking on the water. And when he came toward them, you notice they were terrified because they thought it was a ghost. You know, they lived with the impossibilities. Had to be a ghost. Had to be a mirage. Had to be some, because there's no way that any man could walk upon water. The impossibilities to say, I don't, you know, beyond our understanding, comprehension, to fully realize the power of God. It may be something in your life to be like that, and you just simply want to mark it off, discount it, and they became frightened about what they saw. And these hardened sailors, strong fishermen all their life, were so afraid, they cried out. And in order to calm them, Jesus said, have no fear, in verse 27. Have no fear. That's one of the key messages of the gospel. If we can mark it down, is to say, have no fear. We've lived in these days past pandemic, COVID-19, China virus, coronavirus, whatever you want to call it, whatever it is, that if we've gone through all the different things of saying that we have been plagued by, we've been sick by it. I mean, I've had it, Deborah's had it, I'm definitely sick. I know others that didn't make it, or know of others, to say all the different things. But that's not our only problem. Our biggest problem may not be the sense of physical, may be spiritual, may be far deeper than what we can understand, because you see, fear is a universal emotion. Everybody is afraid of something. We're born, psychologists say, with two present fears. One is fear of loud noises. There's a little baby and get a loud noise and just cause. And the other one is the fear of falling. Those two fears we come into this world with, loud noises and the fear of falling. But it doesn't take us long to accumulate a few other fears, such as the fear of dark. The fear of lightning and thunder, the fear of dogs. Let me tell you, right now, once you've been bitten, you get afraid of dogs, being bitten by dogs. I don't know how many times I've had somebody, and honestly, I have to confess, the first time I was bitten by a dog, though I don't remember it, it was my fault. Because they said, don't hit old Mose, an old coon hound, and I was about 3 years old and out in the yard playing with a stick. And they said, don't bother that dog. And old Mose was laying over not bothering anybody. That's what they called him, Mose. Black and tan coonhound. I can remember that. I thought that dog was going to outlive me. That dog had tumors on you the size of baseballs on him and stuff. And I kept praying that dog. I didn't even know. I wasn't a Christian at the time, but praying that dog would die, because I'd have to, at my grandfather's, I'd have to come past Uncle Hughes, who had that dog. That dog lived to be like 14, 15 years old. I'd be down there, and that dog, so I did apparently hit that dog when I was little. They came out, and he had me on the ground, and he had me by the throat. And they, of course, pulled him off and stuff, and I had a paranoia. Well, later on, I can remember up in Virginia, and we was going to visit some folks, invite them to church, and old Glenn Daugherty, one of the fellows that I'd baptized like you, Blake, into the at the creek at that time, I think, baptized old Glenn, his wife, and some family, and they had a brother-in-law and things, and he wanted me to go visit. So we went visiting one night, and he lived, and we had to go up two flights like of a decking, and there was the cutest little Yorkshire white hair standing out there, and his teeth are snarling like this. I noticed I crossed my fingers when I said cutest. And we were going up to visit, to invite them to tell the gospel story about Jesus, and to invite him. And so that dog got behind me, and Glenn and his son-in-law was in front of me, so I was like a running back. And they were going up steps, and Pat was up above the brother-in-law. Oh, don't worry about him. He's never bit anybody. You ever heard that one? But I've been paranoid about it. I got these fears in me. Even that little old half-pint dog, I mean, he ain't no bigger than my shoe. But boy, he was ugly and he was mean looking. And I was watching him the whole time. And finally he said, "Don't worry about him. I done got up one flight, getting ready to go with none." I said, "Okay, I'll take you at your word." All at once, I felt something grab me right there by the leg. I split between Glenn and his son-in-law. Man, I was up them stairs. I mean, tell you, that little old dog got me. Drew blood on my, and he said, "You know, he's never bit anybody before." And every time I get, I'm telling you, I'm just like, I got this fear, unless it's my dog, about anybody's dog when they say, "He won't bite you." You know, I try to make friends with them, go on and so on, but eventually Pat, by the way, did get saved that we visited and stuff, had prayer up there. But I gave some blood for Jesus, I want all of you to know. So I went up there and did those things. But people get a fear, not just of that, but their fear, not just dogs and thunder and lightning, and fear of people. They don't like crowds, to be in fear of heights, closed in spaces. I heard a story of somebody crawling underneath the house one time, but he tied a rope to his legs, and just in case he got under and got stuck, and his wife hooked a lawnmower to the rope to pull him out. True story, actually. It's a member of Crossway Baptist Church. I'll just let you know. That pulled him out with a riding lawnmower. You know, that had the rope, couldn't get out. He hollered to his wife to get him. That's the funny, you ought to hear him tell it. But fear of closed spaces. You ever get in, sort of, you get there and you can't breathe? You start hyperventilating. You know, what is the fear? See, this is the thing we look at. Trains. Some people won't ride on planes. They won't ride on them. All the different things. There was a lady named Virginia Spring. She wrote to the Reader's Digest many years ago. And her family had gathered together to watch John Paul II visit the United States, the Pope. And when Pope John Paul II visited the United States, he got off the plane. First time being in the United States, got off the plane, and when he did, he kissed the ground. And when he kissed the ground, Virginia's aunt looked over, 80-year-old aunt looked over and says, "I know just exactly how he feels. I hate to fly." And she thought that he was kissing the ground because that he didn't like to fly. Fear is a universal emotion, and many of us are bound by our fears. We're afraid to die. We're afraid of all the different things, and we have to happen within our life. And so when we look at this little story and understand what Jesus is saying, you see, being afraid is a terrible feeling. It paralyzes you, but it's also contagious. You know, I see people today, I hear people and saying, "I'm not going to get my shot because I'm afraid to take the vaccines." Or, "I'm not going to wear my mask. I'm not going to do this or that," to wear, you know, these phobias that we have. Some people won't take theirs because they're afraid that this vaccine's going to do something to you. We got all kinds of different, and that's okay. I respect that. I think every person ought to have the right to make their own choice as long as their choice doesn't affect other people. That's the thing. As long as that, in that, if it has that kind of effect, then that's what you do. You want to respect that, to realize that. But you see, fear is contagious. Now, many of you won't remember this little children's thing, but did y'all ever hear the Chicken Little, the little story where Chicken Little said the sky's falling? It all started with a cabbage leaf fell on her tail. She started running through, and she ran into Henny Penny. She said, "The sky's falling, the sky's falling." And then they both got paralyzed with fear, and Henny Penny, all the fowls of the barnyard, they started running, and this is a simple little children's story. And so they was all squawking and saying, "The sky's falling, the sky's falling," just because a little leaf that fell on Chicken Little's tail feathers, and she thought the sky was falling. As they was running around, they met Mr. Fox. And Mr. Fox, in their panic and paranoiaism, said, "Look, you can stay in my den. It's safe down there." And so all the fowls gathered in to get into the den. But this story has a good connection for us to look at, because all at once, and then Mr. Fox had a delicious meal. Here they were worried about one thing and something else happened. Do you get it? You see, that you could be so paranoid that in the sense of that it becomes contagious, that people, the Bible does not tell us to live in fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and a sound mind. That is the thing when we look at 2 Timothy 1:7. So when we understand that what God gives us is to have strength and faith in Him, but we have to focus ourselves upon Him because fear is a destructive nature. The second thing I noticed today, Matthew tells us that the disciples were terrified and Jesus said, "Take heart, have no fear, it is I." Here's the biblical antidote for fear. Look to Christ. Whatever you're going through within your life, look to Christ. Face Christ. Look at Him. Because that's the thing that you want to focus upon. I don't know if you ever heard of Dr. Norman Vincent Peale. He wrote a lot of, great, tremendous author, wrote a lot of devotional books and things. Pastor up in New York, all the different things. Would you think that a man like Dr. Norman Vincent Peale, we never think about people being strong. We look at them to see that they have any fears, they have any problems. Dr. Norman Vincent Peale was to speak, and today they don't, but years ago, to a crowd of over 1,000 people. And in his anxiety that he lost his voice. I've actually experienced that in going to some revivals over the years to get ready, get worked up, get tremendously anxious or excited. That I Dr. Norman Vincent Peale had to go to a medical doctor. His medical doctor told him, said, "I never thought that I would ever be the one to tell Dr. Norman Vincent Peale to not focus upon your problems, but focus upon God. Don't worry about what God's going to, all these different things," because he became anxious about what he's going to say and all the different things. And he said, the doctor told him, said, "This blood flow that begins to go, you get anxiety, fears begin to build up, paranoia that begins to build up." That's the very thing. You say, what do they tell us concerning anxiety and worries and concerns? A lot of that is called, a lot of stress causes a lot of our diseases, don't it? Whether it's heart disease, whether it's cancer, whether it's other things that if it didn't cause it, it enhances it. It keeps it continually going. You see, the Bible says the disciples were terrified. Do you think about the word terrified? Have you ever been terrified? Scared to death? Isaiah 26 verse 3 says, "Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee." God will keep you in perfect peace. By the way, that's what Philippians says. When Paul's writing in Philippians, he says that he gives, you say, well, what do I experience? Is there a lightning bolt when I get saved? Is there this, there, the earthquake? Is, well, all the different things. Do you know really what we experience in our life when we give our heart to Christ? Is what Paul writes in Philippians says, a peace that surpasses all understanding. I don't know in the midst of the storm why it is, but I just have peace. I ought to be worried, I ought to be afraid, I ought to be concerned, but you know what I'm experiencing? Is that God's given me a peace about it. Peace is what we look for, isn't it? To have peace is a victory, the sense of whether all the things that you're going through within your life, because we can all identify with those many things that we see. The best antidote for fear is to keep your eyes on Jesus. The third thing. The lesson we learn from this story of Jesus walking on the water, this sermon, is that when they were terrified, Jesus told them to take heart, for it was He. But the amazing thing is that there was one in the group, one out of the crowd, when he was saying it's I, and they could have waited, but there was one, and you know his name, Simon Peter, that was here in the boat, and Peter is that kind of rambunctious one that will run where angels fear to trod. He'll say it before blundered out. Some say, Peter said, "Lord, they might leave you, but I'll never forsake you." And Jesus says, "Peter, before the night's over, you're going to deny me." Waiting in the garden, and Peter pulls his sword, and as he's here, and cuts one of the priest's servant's ears off. You know, just he's just reactive. He gets angry, and all the different things. Anybody identify? Don't raise your hand. All the things he has outbursts here. Yeah, his husband said, "I thought you was a Christian." Well, I am, but I'm an angry Christian. Well, I thought you was a Christian. Well, I am. I just don't have enough faith. You know, I'm this or that, because we become weak in several moments of our life, don't we? We're not always as strong as what we would like to be. But in this moment, Peter reaches deep within himself, and Peter says, Lord, if it's really you, here's the test. Sometimes we want to try to put the Lord to the test, don't we? Lord, if it's you, but you be careful what you ask. Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to you. Splash, the water is coming up on the ship. The boat is rocking and all the different things, and all the disciples are holding on here, and here's Peter. Now that they were afraid before, now here's Peter ready to step out into the water. Bid me to come to you, Lord, if it's you. Jesus said, come. Can you just see? You know, sometimes we start out that way. I'll get that handrail and I'm going to step over here and I'd like to see if it's that water really going to hold me up, you know. I mean, putting it down there, is it going to sink down and coming in? And he puts that, but keep your eyes on Jesus, Peter. Stepping out on that boat, holding the edge there until he finally to let go of our safety. And, oh, you talk about shouting ground. I know you, man, had to feel it. Woo! I'm really standing on water. There's no rocks around. I've heard stories where they talked about the priest, the Baptist preacher, and the Methodist, and so on, being out on the lake, and they're out there, and soon one of them gets up out of the boat and walks across like on water, and then the other one gets up and walks on the water, and that third one gets out, and I won't say what denomination, he starts walking across there and sinks, plunge. And the other one looked at him and said, should we tell him where the rocks are? You know, I've heard different ones saying, I'm sure old Peter, out in the middle of the sea, the ocean, and here it is with the waves going, and Peter steps out. That's tremendous faith. That's believing Jesus. That's how you are when you give your life to Christ. But is that not the way that we ought to be when we continue our journey? That's how we start out. That all things are possible with God when we start out. We don't care about all the other stuff. When we get saved, start living for the Lord. But then something interrupts in our life that causes us to quit church, causes this or that, all the different things in our life, and we're no longer going because we can't listen. There's a bunch of hypocrites in church. Not ours, of course. Bunch of hypocrites in church. I'm not going down there. But as the old saying is, I'd rather come worship God with a few hypocrites in church than end up in hell with all the hypocrites. You know, because that's the thing when you say that people, because you get your eyes off Jesus. You're looking at all the things around you that keeps you from doing something rather than gives you a reason to do something. Say amen. That when it comes to your life, the picture that we look at here is Peter begins to, of course, as he steps out and he became conscious of the wind and the waves and he begins to sink down. That's the nature of the life of faith. I can do all things through Christ as long as I keep my eyes on Him. You have to remember that. When you start having difficulties in your life and you start looking at the things surrounding you, then all at once you're going to realize that I can't do it anymore. It's not going to work. Realize what the problem is and what the solution is. Last of all, the most impressive of this miracles of Jesus is not the physical miracles that Jesus did, causing the blind to see, the crippled to walk, changing the water into wine, and here walking upon the sea. The greatest thing that happened was really the moment when Jesus reached down and took Peter by the hand. When Peter called out and said, Lord, save me. You know, when you're sinking, if you realize what is happening and taking place in your life, then you ought to have the sensibility enough to realize where to look to in order to be saved. I love that picture. We went last week down to see that theatrical play of Jesus. And I'm telling you, it was tremendous down at Branson. Yeah, Sight and Sound Theater. And it had this big picture, and some of our friends that was with us had their picture taken for it. But it was Jesus in this angry wave. It's a beautiful picture on this, and everybody was getting their picture in front of it. And it was his hand reaching down. I think you might have put this similar into the, Natalie, in our caption, but Jesus reaching down when Peter was sinking. All you could see was this much of Peter's arm when he was sinking in the sea. You know, the Bible says Peter began to sink. Probably, you've probably gone through sometimes marriage, your job, different things that happens, and you're struggling to have, and you're sinking. But you're going to sink further if you can't come to the truth of crying out to the Lord and saying, Lord, save me. Save me here in salvation. You see, the greatest miracle that Jesus does wasn't the physical sense of reaching down here and getting Peter to bring him up. And when they got in the boat, the Bible says, then the sea just became calm. And everybody began to confess, thou art the Christ. They began to, as Jesus got, just because this miracle to them. But you see, they experienced the miracle of Jesus walking on water. They experienced all those other things that we read about and they preach here in the Bible. They saw him die upon the cross. And they saw him after he resurrected from the grave. They saw him when he ascended up into the clouds of glory in Acts chapter 1. They were there as they were preaching and seeing. They experienced it in their life. And so they could share the story. But the key note wasn't the miracle, the fact that Jesus walked upon the water, because he is God. But the key to it was of what he could do for our fears, to help us to have the calmness. He can calm the waves and the sea, and he can calm those things that are so troubling within our lives and our fears that we're facing right now. And listen to everybody on Facebook that's listening, to everybody here, to say is that we need to see Jesus. We need to keep our eyes focused on him as he's walking in the midst of this storm. And we'll keep our eyes focused and we'll just say, Lord, save me. Because through you all things are possible. And I'm going to walk on this water. Peter did just for a little bit. How amazing. Never did it again that we know of. It never happened again. But you know what? He became one of the greatest preachers. He was the reed that became the rock. When he was, had Jesus told him, said, now when you're converted, preach to your brethren, let them know. And I remember Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost when he come out preaching and 3,000 souls got saved. Because, you know, he experienced something in his life. And it's easy to tell about something you've experienced. And you begin to tell, and people started listening to the story. Millions of lives have been changed all over the world. We don't want it to stop here. The only way that it stops, so there was a fable said that when Jesus got to heaven, that Gabriel, the archangel, asked Jesus and said, well, how did it go? And Jesus said, well, I went down, they beat me and did all these different things. They rejected me. And they hung me up on an old cross and I died. They stuck a spear in my side and nails through my hands, my feet, and everything. And I died physically there upon that earth. And they buried me in a tomb. And I resurrected. And I told Peter and the rest of the disciples, keep preaching. Tell the story. Tell them what you know. Tell them that I arose from the grave. That I'm coming back again. And so Gabriel said, well, but what if they fail? What's plan B? And Jesus said, I don't have any other plan. Because that is the plan that God has. And listen, as it was their responsibility, it is yours and mine. And we do it verbally here and with the life that we live. we need to start walking on water to Jesus and let Him calm all the storms so that we can. Anything that's pulling you down, any concerns that you have, I want to ask you this morning to place them at the feet of Jesus. If you're overwhelmed by fear and paranoia and you got all kinds of excuses, hey, you're going to have to be honest about it. You're going to have to talk about what it is you're feeling and what you see. And I want to promise you a miracle that Jesus will do in your life and give you an unbelievable peace. Pray with me. Thank you, Father, for calming the storms within our life. Thank you for Jesus, our Savior. And as you have spoken to our hearts today, I pray, Lord, that you'll help us in our response, whether it's to come here to this altar and to pray or to share our faith in you. Someone here that's not a Christian that today says, I want to be saved, or I've been saved, I've just given my heart to Christ, I'm going to follow Him in baptism, I'm going to live for Him, or Christians who need to rededicate their life, or someone, Lord, that says, this is where I want to serve the Lord and grow as a Christian and join your fellowship, or whatever the need is, we want to glorify you. Bid us to come to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me as we sing together today. What's our number, honey? What's our hymn? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. It's on the screens. I'll meet you right here at the front if you'd like to, someone to pray with you concerning your decision. Come. If you're in the back of the church, the front, the middle, as God speaks to your heart, it's your choice. Meet you right here at the front. And life more abundant and free. Let's pick it up, ladies.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Let's do that next verse, Deborah. It'll be the last verse, lest someone comes.
Death into life everlasting.
Is God speaking to your heart?
He passed and we follow Him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are.
Sing it out. Has it been good to be in the house of the Lord today? We're so glad, Blake, to have you and family. It's so good to have all of you all here today with us to celebrate Blake's baptism today and the service. Others, Rebecca, it's so good to see you and Corey here today. We're glad that you guys visited. Rebecca back there. Corey, is that? No, wait, I got that wrong, didn't I? Is it Rebecca? I got, oh, I thought I was losing it, getting old or something. So glad to have you all with us today. Are there others visiting with us today? I didn't recognize. I got dot, 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 dot. So glad you're all here. Any other word before we go today? Remember the Bible study, ladies, 6:30 Fellowship Hall. If your ladies come and be with us, I'll be leading that Bible study at this time. I've got somebody in mind to talk to about heading up the Bible study, been praying about it, and so I'm going to be talking to that person here soon. I'm going to be sharing the survey results, and we'll make those decisions again. Pray for us as we continue to go through the repair. The drywall has been put up down in the basement. carpet will be going down soon as we can pick it out and get that stuff. And there'll be the painting and things to do. And we're going to be repairing up here. I appreciate Brian Walters and Blake coming up and doing a little work the other day, the little baseboard trim and stuff where the water drained out there. I love you. I appreciate you. Deborah, thank you and Sharon for filling in for Philip today. And will you lead us in a little something there or as we leave today? Or, y'all thought you was done, didn't you? Y'all forgot there's one more little song to go.
That third verse.
I'll meet y'all out in the back here.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Then we'll just do that third verse.